I am Mr. True.
In this video, I want to talk about higher order derivatives and give you an application which I found was kind of a little interesting over on the internet and try to make a problem out of it. A Bugatti Veyron braking with just its air brake. When we have an application problem, such as an object moving, maybe throwing an object off of a building, in this case, a car being slowed by brakes, be talking about a car under its own acceleration, doing just the opposite. When we're given a position function, we can take that function and find the first derivative, which will give us the velocity of that object. We've done a video of the vertical speed of an object, where we took an object, we threw it up, it had a positive velocity, as it was rising, it reached its maximum height, and then started to fall, it had a negative velocity. Well, the reason why, of course, that object is slowing down is because it's under the gravitational force of the Earth, and the acceleration is, the Earth in terms of feet, is negative 32 feet per second per second. So it slows down and stops rising and begins to fall. So we can find that acceleration by taking the first derivative and finding the derivative again. That is the acceleration of the object as opposed to its velocity. So we can take a function, we can take its derivative, in this case our independent variable is t, so the derivative with respect to t of the original function is our first derivative. We can take that first derivative and find the derivative again and get the second derivative. Or the notation is take the original function s of t, in this case our position function, and find the second derivative, but we're gonna go through them, like find the first and then get to the second, then get to the third and get to the third. We're not going to go straight to like the fourth derivative. We're going to work our way down. So I'm fudging this a little bit because I know that air resistance is not a linear force. The faster you go, the more air resistance and the more that strength that air resistance has on your car, in this case moving. But I thought this was an interesting note and I wanted to make a problem out of it because I don't want to just take them right out of the book and have any kind of copyright issues. So forgive me on the I believe in proper physics of this question, but interesting fact. A Bugatti Veyron, which is some ridiculously expensive, very fast, 1,000-horsepower car, has an air brake at the end of it. It goes so fast that it brakes and it pops a swing up on the back. It holds at 55 degrees, and supposedly that generates 70% of the braking force of a normal car. I really strongly don't believe that that's going to be a constant 70%. Because I don't really believe that to be a linear thing, but at a certain speed, it is 70%. It's an interesting fact, so we're going to hold it as being linear, just in the sake of this problem. So I couldn't just, because I don't want to just take something out of the book. if a Bugatti Veyron were traveling at 220 feet per second, which is 150 miles per hour, and could brake with just the air brake, but why would? It's got these humongous brakes and brake discs. Its position function would be, I've made up a position function based on the gravitational force because that's what you always read about in magazines and you feel in a car. It's how hard is your body pressing against the back of the seat or the sides of the seat, or when you're braking you feel your body push into the seatbelt. So I'm going to assume that an average car can brake at a full 1G of force when you're under panic braking. And we've got, therefore, a position function which is negative 1/2 times 70% of what I'm assumed to be a reasonable braking force of an average car of 1G of force, or negative 32 feet per second, times t squared plus 220t. This is the initial velocity we have in the problem. And we get a position function of negative 11.2 t squared plus 220t. Okay, so this is going here. If we take that function and we find the first derivative, we got a power rule here, so 2 times negative 11.2 is negative 22.4 t. This has a degree of 1, so we're just going to do 1 times 220 and get, or just the derivative of that is just 220. So this function will tell me the speed of the car at any given moment in time after the air brake is applied and the car starts to slow. Then if I take this function and I find the derivative again, then we get, this is a constant, so the derivative of a constant is 0, so this is just going to be s double prime of t is equal to negative 22.4. So our acceleration function is a constant function. We're accelerating or decelerating at 22.4 feet per second per second, because that's how the problem was initially set up. So our acceleration is a constant value, so I'm not going to do any examples on that. But what is the speed of the car after 2 seconds? Well, that's the first derivative. We'll tell you the speed. So we've got negative 22.4 times 2 plus 220, and that is going to be equal to negative 44.8 plus 220, and that comes out to be 175.2 feet per second. After 6 seconds, how fast is it going to be traveling? Well, that's this negative 22.4 times 6 plus 220, and that is going to come out to be, when you're done with it, 85.6 feet per second. Excuse the interruption. So we have the speed at 2 seconds, we have the speed at 6 seconds. I want to now find the average rate of change between the 2 and 6 second periods. You might notice that I'm going to do a lot of work, and you could have just taken these two numbers, added and divided by 2, and got the same answer. That is showing up because my velocity function is linear. That is not always the case. So when you want to find average velocity, please make sure that you use the original function with the, you know, time periods in question, and you actually find through the process, through the formula of average velocity, what that answer is, not just trying to notice some kind of like shortcut that showed up in one question and you think it applies all the time. So the average rate of change between seconds 2 and 6 is going to be found by taking, we're going to take 6 seconds, plugging in the original position function. So we have negative 11.2 times 6 squared plus 220 times 6 minus, now we're going to take the 2 seconds and plug it in. So we have negative 11.2 times 2 squared here, yes, plus 220 times 2 all over the change in t, the change in time, which 6 minus 2 is equal to 4. Now, I'm not going to try and do that off the top of my head. I'll just say that this comes out to be 916.8 minus 395.2 divided by 4, which comes out to be approximately 130.4 feet per second. I'm Ms. Drew. I hope this helped you understand a little bit the purpose and how we use first and second derivatives to describe the velocity of an object and the acceleration of an object at any given point in time. My example just happened to have a constant deceleration value. I'm Mr. Drew. Bam! Go do your homework.